On September 11, 2001, members of the Islamic fundamentalist terrorist group Al-Qaeda attacked the United States. The terrorists hijacked commercial airplanes and crashed them into the World Trade Center in New York and the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. A fourth plane, Flight 93, saw the passengers fight back against the terrorists to try to take back the plane. The terrorists crashed the plane into a field in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, before it could get to its purported target, the White House or the Capitol building. The nation was stunned at the devastation and loss of life. Both towers of the World Trade Center had collapsed, America's military headquarters had been attacked, and nearly 3,000 people were killed in the attacks on 9/11. President George W. Bush spoke from the Oval Office that evening to reassure the American people in the wake of the horrendous attacks.
A great people has been moved to defend a great nation. Terrorist attacks can shake the foundations of our biggest buildings, but they cannot touch the foundation of America. These acts shatter steel, but they cannot dent the steel of American resolve.
A few days later, President Bush stated his desire to bring Al-Qaeda's leader, Osama bin Laden, to justice. Bin Laden was being harbored by the Taliban regime that ran Afghanistan.
I want him held. I want justice. And there's an old poster out west, as I recall, that said, wanted, dead or alive.
On October 7, 2001, the United States launched Operation Enduring Freedom, which began with airstrikes against Taliban and Al-Qaeda targets in Afghanistan. After the air campaign softened Taliban defenses, the coalition began a ground invasion, with Northern Alliance forces providing most of the troops, and the U.S. and other nations giving air and ground support. On November 12th, a little over a month after the military action began, Taliban officials and their forces retreated from the capital of Kabul. By early December, Kandahar, the last Taliban stronghold, had fallen, and Taliban leader Mullah Muhammad Omar went into hiding rather than surrender. Al-Qaeda fighters continued to hide out in Afghanistan's mountainous Tora Bora region, where they were engaged by anti-Taliban Afghan forces backed by U.S. Special Forces troops. Al-Qaeda soon initiated a truce, which is now believed to have been a ploy to allow Osama bin Laden and other key Al-Qaeda members time to escape into neighboring Pakistan. By mid-December, the bunker and cave complex used by Al-Qaeda at Tora Bora had been captured, but there was no sign of bin Laden. In the following years, U.S. forces searched for him along the Afghanistan-Pakistan border, during which time bin Laden remained absent from the public eye. Then, in October 2004, less than a week before that year's U.S. presidential election, bin Laden emerged in a videotape message in which he claimed responsibility for the September 11th attacks. After that, he periodically released audio messages, including in 2008 when he threatened retaliation for the deaths of Palestinians in the Gaza Strip, and in 2009 when he challenged the nerve of the new U.S. President Barack Obama to continue the fight against Al-Qaeda. The hunt for bin Laden was cold until around 2007 when U.S. intelligence officials discovered the name of one of bin Laden's closest couriers, Abu Ahmed al-Kuwaiti, whom they speculated may have been involved in supporting or harboring the terrorist. By late 2010, analysts were able to link the courier to a large, highly secured compound in Abbottabad, Pakistan, a town about 35 miles north of Islamabad. The compound's unusual and extensive security features, along with further intelligence information, prompted suspicion that the residence was Osama bin Laden's hideout. While the CIA and the Obama administration were working to confirm who was in the compound, the elite SEAL Team 6 began training and working on a mock-up of the compound. In 2011, in the weeks leading up to the bin Laden raid, CIA set up a door-to-door vaccination program in the city of Abbottabad with a Pakistani doctor, Shakil Afridi, in an attempt to get DNA samples from the occupants of the house where it's suspected the Al-Qaeda leader was living. Afridi played a role in collecting swabs from bin Laden's children for identification purposes to help determine if they were bin Laden's relatives. On April 29, 2011, President Barack Obama authorized a small special operations team known as SEAL Team 6 to carry out a raid on the compound. Operation Neptune Spear began in the early morning hours of May 2nd, Pakistani time. In a daring raid 120 miles inside Pakistan, SEAL Team 6 flew from Afghanistan to bin Laden's hiding place in the dead of night. President Obama and his security team watched the operation in real time from the White House, receiving updates as the raid unfolded. SEAL operator Robert O'Neill recalled that on the way to Abbottabad to try and keep his mind sharp, he would count up to 1,000 and then back down to zero. Then a quote from President George W. Bush came into his head.
Freedom itself was attacked this morning by a faceless coward, and freedom will be defended.
O'Neill began reciting that quote now as the helicopters approached Abbottabad. The stealth helicopters swooped down on the compound, and the SEALs began sweeping through the buildings within the high-walled enclosure. In the main building, the SEALs began clearing each floor and confronting terrorists shooting at them. Four terrorists were killed by the SEALs before they arrived on the third floor. Robert O'Neill was the number two man heading up the stairs to the third floor. The leading SEAL tackled two women on the third floor out of fear that they were wearing explosive vests. That left O'Neill now face-to-face with the world's most wanted terrorist, Osama bin Laden. O'Neill fired three times, killing bin Laden instantly. That is when the call was made to Admiral William McRaven, "For God and Country, Geronimo, 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 EKIA, Enemy Killed in Action." U.S. forces snagged valuable items from the compound during the raid. 10 computer hard drives, 5 computers, and more than 100 storage devices were retrieved. Osama bin Laden's personal journal was also recovered. These materials provided much-needed intelligence about bin Laden's role within al-Qaeda and the organization's inner workings. After 40 minutes, the SEALs were on their way back to Afghanistan with bin Laden's body. The U.S. team was forced to abandon one of its helicopters after it was damaged in a hard landing at the compound site. It was mostly destroyed in the explosion set by the U.S. forces as they departed. Within hours, his body was buried at sea. Religious rites were carried out on the deck of a U.S. aircraft carrier, the USS Carl Vinson. The body, shrouded in a white sheet and placed in a weighted bag, was then positioned on a flatboard, tipped up, and eased into the Arabian Sea. It was 11:35 Eastern Standard Time on May 1, 2011, when President Barack Obama made his famous walk down the long hallway leading to the East Room in the White House.
"Tonight, I can report to the American people and to the world that the United States has conducted an operation that killed Osama bin Laden, the leader of al-Qaeda, and a terrorist who's responsible for the murder of thousands of innocent men, women, and children."
President Obama had also made a call to former President George W. Bush, who had tried to get bin Laden his whole presidency, informing him of the successful mission. The killing of Osama bin Laden was a significant victory for the United States. For many families of 9/11 victims, bin Laden's death symbolized justice and retribution. The terrorist leader was not only a major player within al-Qaeda, but also a figurehead that attracted supporters and recruits from around the world. Although the war on terror would continue, the American people took solace in knowing that the man who orchestrated the 9/11 attacks could no longer do them harm again.